Hey guys, today we're talking about my least favorite reads of 2014. Before we get into that though, I wanted to announce something that's probably only important to me, but I've decided to call this segment the Wiggins Library. We used to recap Buffy the Vampire Slayer on Snark Squad, and we called the Sunnydale High School Library the Wiggins Library, because when Buffy first goes in there, she says the place gives her Wiggins.
That place just kind of gives me the Wiggins.
You probably won't see that anywhere except for the title card and the playlist, but there you go. Makes me happy. Moving on. I'd seen a couple videos where people are kind of listing off their 14 favorite reads of the year for 2014, and that's cool, but I also want to talk about the things that I didn't like, so I'm doing my 7 least favorite and 7 favorite reads of the year. Starting with least favorite. Number 7 is Black Hour by Laurie Reeder Day. I especially didn't like it because of the poor pacing, but it had a central mystery, so it was just enough to keep me reading. And every time it would woo me back into the story, like it would just die and plod along again. Until the end, the resolution was not great. It all fit, but it was almost too contrived. I didn't buy the villain, I didn't buy the motivations of the villain, and it just kind of overall felt like a letdown. I gave it 2 out of 5 stars. Number 6 is The Magicians by Lev Grossman. Ooh, the characters were so annoying. There wasn't one character that I could root for, that I liked, even an anti-hero. Quentin was the worst. I think Mr. Grossman played that up purposefully to a point. Quentin was kind of an unhappy fellow. He was just, you know, a very emo kind of guy. But at the same time, he was just kind of an insufferable jerk. Anytime a female character kind of walked into the scene, he would constantly just describe them by their attractiveness and their breast size. Like, he does fit, I think it's 4 or 5 years of school into one book, and it just felt so disconnected to me. He jumped around from year to year, and there didn't seem to be a sense of why he was telling us what he was telling us. Why this particular scene? Why these details? Why this? It was just kind of this conglomeration of things that happened to them in the 5 years, and it, to me, it just missed the mark time and time again. I gave it 2 out of 5 stars. Number 5 is Alienated by Melissa Landers. This was one of those YA novels that I would describe as juvenile. You can read YA and have the characters be age appropriate, or not even, they can be young, but it doesn't, the writing and the storytelling doesn't also have to be juvenile. You can have a young voice without having a dumbed down story. Alienated was totally a dumbed down story and had these big themes and big things that it wanted to discuss about xenophobia and just like extraterrestrial and other things that this girl goes through, the prejudice that she goes through because she's housing this alien and whatnot, but it's done in totally a superficial way and just kind of brushed off for the end game of this love story, of course, because it's YA. So I gave it 2 out of 5 stars. Number 4 is The Madman's Daughter by Megan Shepherd. I just thought to myself, the worst part was definitely when they were on the boat trying to get to the island, because it was so repetitive. It was just like, we're on a boat. We're on a boat again. We're still on a boat. And that was kind of went on for way too long. But then I remembered the island. Probably one of my biggest pet peeves is the ill-conceived love triangle. Authors love to build this whole elaborate world and plot around it, but it's all just to hold the ill-conceived love triangle. That definitely was the case in this book, where she's on this island and there are these creatures and she's running for her life, and seriously, at one point there's like a monster outside of her door, it's banging on her windows, and she takes up some knitting and she starts thinking about the boys in her life to kind of distract herself from the ever-present danger. Like, that is such a great example of what these books do sometimes and why it bothers me. There's literally a monster at your door and you're thinking about which boy you should choose. The characters were all pretty much shells of characters. Juliet, which I just looked up her name, she just kind of runs around on the island getting lost a lot. Her father is a mustache twirling kind of villain. And then the second part of the love triangle is just like a shorter leg. Like, this triangle never really reaches full potential. He's very vague on purpose, and there's a plot twist when it comes to him. He just kind of follows Juliet around, like, not saying much because he has to be vague and clenching his jaw and you know, doing vague character stuff. I gave this 2 out of 5 stars. Number 3 is 10 Tiny Breaths by K.A. Tucker. Admittedly, I was not sure what to expect when I picked up this book. What I did was I sorted my to-be-read shelf on Goodreads, and I was just looking at the highest rated, and this one happened to be one of the highest rated books. So I was like, oh, cool, awesome. I have that. I will pick it up and read it because it is so highly rated. Goodreads lies to you sometimes. It was just a bunch of fluff and cheese. I really don't remember the plot, to be honest. I remember she worked at a strip joint and she was like messed up from something in her past. And you know, that I think that is the plot, actually. I think I just remembered it. That was pretty much it. The writing kind of hits every YA romance trope that you could think of. So there's lopsided grins and she doesn't know how pretty she is, and she kind of, you know, sputters and stutters around male attention, and just like everything you've ever read before in a YA romance in this book. 2 out of 5 stars. Number 2 is Girl Online by Zoe Sugg. There was a lot of noise going on because it came out, I suppose, that that parts of it were ghostwritten, or it was ghostwritten. I don't know what was ever confirmed or denied. But meanwhile, I was just really, really surprised that anyone was employed or paid to write this book. It was so bad. This was like cliches done by your mom. Like, if your grandma googled, you know, YA cliches and then read and then regurgitated, like, that's this book. The love interest has a crooked smile, but then when she describes it, she says it's lopsided and he has several holes on his face. And she means dimples. You have 2 dimples. I don't know why she says several holes. I'm just imagining this guy. Like, crater face. I don't know what's going on. That's how stuffy it feels, which is mind-blowing because it's about a blogger. It's about a girl who's supposed to be, like, hip on internet culture. I don't know, and a YouTube sensation dude. And no. She includes these blog entries every so often in the book, and it's just kind of painful to read. Like, it slogs down an already slow plot. Like, there isn't much plot. It wasn't good. 1 out of 5 stars. Number 1 is Dark Fever by Karen Marie Monning. Male leads in this story are abusive. They push her around. There's a kind of this, like, paranormal rape thing that happens where one of the characters just has this effect on her where she starts taking off her clothes and wants to have sex even though she doesn't really want to because she's being affected on her emotions. So you have this, like, very vapid girl being pushed around about these manly men who we can't hear enough about how manly these men are, and the entire situation is pretty gross. Baron, who is set up as, I think, the main love interest, like, nothing really happens between them, but he's being set up in a way where we're constantly told how handsome he is, and then by the end that he rescues her and he paints her toenails or some such nonsense. But throughout the entire book, he's, like, choking her and pushing her around, and she's so dumb. So you have this one, he either chokes her or throws her or something, and then she's thinking to herself, I don't know, he could be dangerous. And you're like, seriously? He's choking you like 27 times. He bruised your rib. What do you mean you think he's dangerous? He's terrible. I read this so long ago. Mostly I just remember that he chokes her. And everyone's like, yay, book. This is a great book. Everything is perfect with this book. Let's read it a lot. Nobody should read this book. The dialogue and the writing weren't particularly good. Baron does that, like, hot guy, bad boy thing that I'm specifically thinking happens a lot in 50 Shades of Grey, where he calls Mac Miss Lane a lot. And so you know that things have changed when he calls her Mac at the end of the book because, oh, look, he used the name that she prefers. And she has told him before, call me this. And he's like, no, I'm not gonna because, you know, I do what I want. And so you're like, oh, swoon. I don't know why people like this stuff. I'm just telling you what happens. But it kind of, it's hilarious because you've got these fae and all this sex and people choking each other, and you're still reading it going, oh my god, get on with the story already. I don't think it ever does. I don't really think it ever gets on with that story. I originally gave it 2 stars, but right now I just decided to give it 1 out of 5 stars. So there you have it, my 7 least favorite reads of 2014. I will be back with my favorite reads soon. See you guys then.